lesson 101 says we promised to have a 101 session for every talk. And I've just used Sonka style to use terminal presentation. So first, that polymorphism is that we have kind of interface so that we could reuse the code, right? Saying that we want to replicate something with just integer, then we just replicate a number three times is in dot test, and so replicate model 1, 3, it will give us three elements, right? But if I want to reuse this function, then it would be better to pass in anything and replace the same thing for three times. So how to make it into polymorphic? Like saying that we want to pass in anything beside integer, we could just specify a type variable for any character you use, and with that, I could define replicate polymorphism for that. Then I want to replicate true for three times. Replicate poly for three times, or replicate replicate 1.0 for three times. That could be anything you want to pass in. Like still integer would work, right? So specifying a parameter as a type variable, that will make the function polymorphic directly. So it's a, because with type variable, that means you want to, it will serve as a placeholder for type information. So that means without any constraint, we don't know about what you are going to put in. So, and for the implementation itself, it also assumes nothing about it because it's pretty straightforward, just calling itself and prepending the element to the head of the list. So with this information, we don't need the object, any information about the object itself, right? Because we just put something we don't know yet to the head of the list. Yeah, okay. And the A symbol could be anything. You could want to make an emoticon like that. That would also work. So, but somehow that sometimes you want to add some constraint for that, for the object you pass it in. And with this, I'm going to introduce a concept called type class. But I'm going just introduce how to use it without presenting how to define it. This, that would be next one-on-one session. So with print function, that means we want the thing passing in to be printable on the screen. That means the object could be encoded into a string. And the string itself could be put into the console. So we show which is defined in the prelude. So that means we constrain the A passing with this parameter to be showable. That show would have its building definition of how to convert an object into a string. And with that string, we could print it onto the screen, like passing with 3.14159 as double, then with float, with double, that is building inside the prelude. So we could know that it's printable in the print like that. Yeah. So besides show, there are a few of type class that means constraint here to use. Like if I want to implement a function that's checking if the element exists in a list, like I pass in an element which is here, the E element, and passing another list, I want to return true for the element exists in the list. And without any element and just return false. And with pattern matching, Edge as the head of the list and comparing to the element, comparing the head with the element passing. If it's equal, then return true, otherwise return false. But with that, there's a presumption here is that the A has to be comparable to be equal or not, right? So we add EQ means equation for A. That means the A element passing have to we have to work on an equal operator on that. Without that, we can't just assume there's an equal operator implemented here. So with that, any... that would return true because one is in the list, right? Otherwise, then it's false. So with these two examples, then you know you could also constrain the element passing by type parameter. So this is for the function implementation, especially for pure function. But with the data structure you define, that you could also use type parameter. Here's A. That in the previous one-on-one session, we know how to define a recursive data algebraic type, right? With list is either a null or the rest of list and this element. So this is our user-defined list. It's not built inside a compiler. The A could be anything. So this is a polymorphic list. Then with the length implementation, then I'm just that adding one for each of the element using pattern matching. Once I bump into a cons, then adding one and calculate the rest of the list. This is implementation also not related to the element itself, right? Because I'm just calculating how many elements inside. I have no information about the element itself, but I have information about the list. So I don't have, okay. So with list defined, then this. This is one, and I could add more. This two, and now. And I could change it to other stuff like flow, double, or even true, and false. That doesn't evolve into anything about the length implementation. So A could be anything, and we didn't add any constraint on that. So yeah, so here basically is the definition. And so besides specifying type parameter in the signature, that's one thing special to Haskell is that we have higher order thing that sort of you can specify the information on the underlying structure that say we have a higher order function called map that's just changing the underlying structures elements. So with a given list, which is a structure, then I could transform it into another list, but without any information about the A. And later on, in the later of the talk, I will also say that the list could also be changed with the higher order structure defined. So map means that just given a function, then it could work on the element type A, and with that fx applied, then the output of the function will be type B, and reconstruct the list again. to be the transform list of type B, right? So with this defined, and I could just say I want to, wait, I need the int list. So with int list defined, that saying I want to check if the list is not is odd, then it will transform the list into the result of whether it's an odd number or not. It's true and false and true with the int list defined as 1, 2, 3. Okay. Any questions so far? Yeah. Okay. Now a little bit harder for that is fold. That Simon just mentioned about the fold R1, right? That fold is reduced in Lisp or Ruby. That given a list of that and a binary operator, that you like scratch it into the result. That with 1, 2, 3 and plus, then we just sum up the list. And there's two versions. One is make the operator left associative. That means just apply the function first. To if you draw into abstract syntax tree, that means apply the parenthesis to the left side first, then to the next one. So with this recursive define, then we could just fold everything with that. So fold lab associated y and start an initial value with 0. Then I could get the sum up of 6. And another version is make the fold y associated. That's because it's work on the folds is a higher order concept that we could use it for redefine the any function we previously defined. The right is basically the same as left associated. Just if you draw into an abstract syntax tree, it's just you have a parenthesis for the right hand side first, then keep going to until the left end. So you could see that you could just you recursively apply to the function itself, then call the function passing at the outermost. So with that structure, then it means we skew to the end of the list, then getting forward, then finally get our result. And with these two functions defined, I mean higher order concept, we could use that function to redefine any. So with fold L, it's the building definition for fold left associated. And with that, with any, then we just pass in a function that which is the results. So result so far and the current element. We want to ORed, it's a shortcut OR, right? So with the current result and comparing it to the current element, whether they are equal. If they are equal, then means the element exists in the list, right? And start with the false. So any one of them comparing equal, then the whole list will be true. Otherwise, keep going, then it will be false. Yeah. And 1, 2, 3, 1. And with 0. Oh, it's doubled. It's like that, right? So it's the same implementation, but I could reuse the concept, the folding concept, that it could, in my opinion, it's also kind of polymorphism somehow. your library. That means the container with a folding defined. I constraint, it's a metaphor, not exact metaphor, but it's easier for comprehension. It's no longer a list here, right? You see, comparing to the here is a list, right? But here I specify a T. And the T, I also adding a constraint to let it to be foldable. And with the T defined, is as long as the structure or the container those things passing defined with fold function, then you could reuse this function. So with this defined, I could still reuse any fold one because the list is have a fold already defined in the prelude, the standard library. So that's somehow generalize the any to another level. And I didn't define here, I promise for I missed it. For map, you could also use map with specifying its functor t like that, and dA and dB with the same definition. So far, functor means that you could, functor means the structure is have a map defined on it. Then with list is also defined, with the existing list, it's already defined in the standard library, but this, I didn't define it. But with that specifying that, you could also make the map we use for any container have a map defined. Yeah, so that's all. Yeah, I hope it's not too complicated for, especially for foldable. Is it okay? Like foldable means you specify a constraint that you could squash the structure into with a binary operator to into one final value. Okay. Any question?
Cool.
Yeah.
So in this case, your any foldable wouldn't be applicable to your list, right? Because you don't define your list as a foldable, right?
Yeah, but because it involved the type class, I would rather to leave it for the next session.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a trade-off that if I involve too much, speak too much, that would like involve too much thing about type class. So I only teach how to use it, but without defining. Because with that, you have to define either foldable or foldmap or foldar on the underlying container.
Another thing, I don't know whether it's right in the execution model of Haskell, but it's looking like the previous any, it could finish without going through the whole list. And it seems like the second any would need to go through the whole
list.
Yeah,
that would depend on the strictness of the evaluation. That there have a few versions of fold, that there are strict versions of fold, fold L, and which would apply this function first before expanding the structure. And there, for this version, is like without evaluating this function and expanding the whole list to the end. If I recall correctly. Yeah.
Could we just derive the foldable for our custom list? Like Fu mentioned, we don't have it, but could we just derive it?
I'm not pretty sure can we divide foldable for user recursive define algebraic?
I think yes, yeah.
There's you could just try.
Yeah. There's an extension for that.
Okay. Should I add something?
No,
I would just do it.
Just do
that.
Yeah. Source file, or you copy and pasted it. Oh, you copy and pasted. You didn't load the source
because
file.
It's GSCI is another session. So
okay, you could say
that top dot task for
it. Yeah. I mean, what you can do is colon set minus x derive foldable.
So
that would work in general. That
colon
set.
Colon x
set. And then you can
x
give arbitrary
derived
foldable.
Yeah, that would work.
Okay. So with this thing, okay, we've defined any foldable one and cons one. No. Yeah, it seems to work. Social and chat. I don't know beyond have anything that maybe we could move to a Hawker Center if you want to clean this place up.
Yeah, this is just someone help me out with some tables, but feel free to mingle around for a while.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
So the plan is putting the tables back and then go to the box center.
Okay.
turn that off. Because that's a bit loud.